I'm Nigerian. I grew up in Nigeria and Cameroon.
I am half French, half Tunisian, grew up in a small town in the Tunisian desert.
I'm South African and I grew up in Johannesburg, in the south of Johannesburg.
I am from Lesotho and I partly grew up in Lesotho, and then I went to high school in Norway and varsity in the US, and I've been living in South Africa in the last 8 years.
I was born and bred in Lusaka, Zambia, and I did my schooling there till high school, and then I did my tertiary school at the Durban University of Technology.
So I'm from Ethiopia and I grew up in Addis Ababa, which is the capital city. And I also studied my first degree there and then moved to South Africa and then Europe and back to Africa.
I am from a small town in Kenya called Nyahururu that has a very interesting waterfall called the Thompson Falls.
The algorithms, I think, that's interesting, because I think it was actually more the process than the actual tech.
Well, it was kind of, I was playing with Pong when I was like 4 years old, and from then on it's been a love story.
I did an undergraduate degree in engineering, and I guess it was one of those things where you just figure out playing with things, wanted to do more, wanted to learn more to code, and that was where I began my path.
I like breaking things. That was how I started getting into technology. I remember my mom being upset with me for breaking her clock. And it just got worse from there on out.
I'm a cosmologist, and so mostly working in data. And just basically, you know, when you work in data, basically you are very much close to all the technologies. So that's, I would say, like, it's a natural adoption.
So my father is an electrical engineer. And my two sisters, who are 10 years older than me, 10 years and 11 years older than me, they're also electrical engineers. So so it was basically something I was meant to get into, I think. And I was really interested in math and physics. So that's how I got it. You know, I decided to study electrical engineering, and then I was doing something like analog circuit design, which is something different from what I'm doing right now. And then I was kind of veering off into different directions, and at some point worked at Apple for 6 years, and then went back to my PhD, and then halfway through my PhD I discovered computer vision, and I decided to work on computer vision. It's a very roundabout sort of journey.
Initially, I wanted to become an accountant, and so there's this issue of you applying, using CAO to apply for what you want to study. So I had a number of selections that I'd made, accounting, technology and stuff. So I can't remember other options that I made, but so it just ended up that I got picked to do IT at the Durban University of Technology, and that's how I got myself involved in technology.
A scarcity mentality. We had one lab in my school, and we had to share computers. So it was interesting that it was such a scarce resource.
I think we need more professors in our universities, not just universities, also in our K-12 systems, getting the kids ready to program at an early age, generally making the population more statistically savvy. I think that would help a lot.
I think solving our problems will be important for us as Africans, as opposed to trying to address problems that we do not experience.
In general, I think the human resource should be built, and infrastructures, at least in the form of like internet connections, as well as also training young people in current latest technology should be, I think, a priority.
Our mindset sometimes needs to change. So I'll give you an example that might seem completely unrelated, right? So in Ethiopia, when you look at traditional furniture or something that is created, like beds, you know, it's handcrafted, really beautiful wood, really unique kind of work, right? And so, but now, when you look at these works, we don't really value them. We're just importing everything. Like, we're importing some random, you know, little things from everywhere. And so, I think that what we need to do is have a mindset of, you know, what do we need in the continent? What can we build that will work for our context rather than just importing technology? So even with artificial intelligence, I think that's what we need to do. So for example, in Ethiopia, you know, 80% of Ethiopians are farmers. And even when there are technological initiatives, like when they have, what are they called, these incubators and things like that, right? We're not working on things that are going to be useful for the majority of people. So I think our mindset needs to change about what we're creating technology for, and who we're creating it for. And I think that we need to make sure we give our young people opportunities. So if they're going to study AI, if they're going to study machine learning or any of these things, you know, what kinds of opportunities do they have in the country?
I think Africa needs to solve its own problems to be competitive. I think Africans should just solve their own problems, use their own resources, like their own formulation. We just need to have impact in Africa, and then we'll be competitive.
Africa has to believe in itself and have an appetite to learn and find the right mentors.
I guess the foundation of the competitive nature of the African machine learning community is to do what we're doing here at the Indaba, is to build a community together. And if we build together, then we'll be able to build those ideas, to get funding, to create startups, to strengthen our universities, to do more research, and to support everyone who has left our continent to bring it back.
Quite a number of things that have to be done. One is more like preserving our skill set. So what's happening is when people get these AI skills, they run away from Africa and go to Europe and these other places. And then consequently, we Africa still remain lacking, you know, in terms of that area. And then the other thing is, you know, to encourage things like the deep learning in Indaba. Of course, there's this deep learning in Indaba X, where we try to build capacity in the area of machine learning. So these are things that have to be encouraged to bring as many people as possible into this area of AI. And I think if universities can also start lecturing at undergrad level, because most of the people that are in AI are people who are either in research or people that are just passionate about it and then have taken up that initiative to kind of learn AI by themselves.
To not be afraid to learn and to experiment and to fail and to do new things every day.
That actually you can go much, much further than you would ever believe if you're truly passionate about what you do.
The differences between synthetic knowledge and the abstract one and the interpretation, had that been clearer, I think I would have done better.
Much of the stuff is really old. Much of the really functional stuff is really old. Backpropagation goes back to the 70s. Neural networks existed for a very long time. Much of the benefits we've been getting are because of advanced computational power. I think that's useful to drill into people early on.
To trust my own thoughts, to trust my design process, to trust my interests, that my interests will actually help me formulate useful questions.
Not to feel that you are in a rush, that you have to know everything now. It can take you 5 years to learn one simple concept, and that time is fine and is good and it works.
Honestly, you know, I was talking to a student of mine, Rested, that we're working on a project together, and what I was telling her was that, you know, as a woman, as a black woman especially, when you start out, you feel a lot of bias, discrimination, whatever, and you always think you're crazy. Well, I always thought I was crazy. I was like, am I imagining things? Am I oversensitive? Am I like, is this correct? Is this not? And I wish someone just told me, you're not crazy. These are things to be expected, or you should negotiate. People will interrupt you. People will appropriate your ideas. This is stuff that happens. And it would have saved me a lot of time, you know? And so that's what I wanted to tell people. And another thing I wish I knew is that, you know, to always support separate your performance in some metric from your innate ability. Or Omoju had a really great TED talk about like learning, how to do science education. Because a lot of times when you don't learn like someone else, or when you don't do well on a test or something like that, you automatically think, oh, I just died, this is not meant for me, I guess I'm not good at this or whatever. And so I want to, you know, after someone kind of told me to separate those two things.
By impact on the ground, the number of people that are using the tool, the number of people that are being changed by the tool.
Yeah, the NGO that we're working to pilot this project is working with about 30,000 women. And the main goal is to, because majority of these women are women that are not financially included, so they've resorted to informal financials way, the informal way of doing financial services. So we want to provide formal financial services and subsequently include them into the formal financial sector. So I think in that regard, my work has been very impactful.
Impact for me, because now I work in a startup, is judged in terms of business. Are we growing? Are we serving our clients? Are they happy with us?
It's actually very hard to judge the impact of your work, but I guess the one way to judge for me is to see if you've made a contribution to the way people understand and think. And when I come to events like this, and people do tell me that they value the perspective that I brought, and that I consider as an impactful piece of work.
And we're proud of what we do because we help the community, and when we create success stories, that really makes a difference for us.
Well, some of my current work tries to encourage people to use noise in beneficial ways in learning systems. Another part of my current work focuses on trying to inform decision makers that machine learning algorithms are valuable if they're used incorrectly. I think getting more buy-in at a higher level on the ways in which these models can go wrong is important, not just because, well, it's important because it allows the models to be used more widely and in more principled manners. I think that's important.
There's always this pressure to just publish all the time, and I don't like that. And so every conference deadline, you know, just people scrambling to publish all the time. And what's really interesting, what I learned a lot from the last year, is I met Joy Bolognini, who's my collaborator, also a student at MIT Media Lab. And I felt like, you know, she didn't really feel the pressure of publishing all the time. So she stays with one idea, one paper, and tries to maximize that impact. And a paper is just for her, just a way to, one way of having impact. So, for example, when we were working on this project called Gender Shades, it's a paper, she had the idea of, before we release the paper, that we would send the results to different companies to give them a chance to improve their product before the paper is published, right? 1 month before. And then after that, we have, you know, a website, and she has like a spoken word that piece that is about the project and all sorts of publicity. And I know, for now, because of that paper, definitely companies have improved their products, and they've brought, you know, they have press releases about it. They, you know, a lot of news articles are written about it. Almost everybody knows about it. I hear about this paper, and when I'm in any sort of conference, and a lot of individuals are starting to think about bias in AI, you know. And so for me, that's kind of, and I don't think it's the number of citations or whatever. I think this is kind of how I would measure impact. You know, how many real people's lives were affected and how many things were changed.
I mean, it's not only me. I think the whole world knows, like, we are at the very at the age where it's equivalent to the industrial revolution. So, which means everything depends on, you know, how countries in Africa fare in not only just consuming but also being producers of the technology.
I think technology is already having quite an impact in Africa, and there is such a huge potential for us to even use technology more for healthcare, for agriculture, for congestion, and for all the many crazy things happening.
We have many interesting kind of developmental problems, developmental challenges, especially in the age where what we need to do is consider a new kind of development, a new kind of politics, a new kind of sustainable vision for our continent, in which we are not united in some sense by injustices of the past, but where we can be united by a new vision of the future. And I think one of those visions that unites us is science, and I think technology and science is the way that we can build a new kind of Pan-African movement of Pan-African togetherness across our continent.
I think that one of the things we struggle with on the continent is unemployment, and we have a very young population. So in Ethiopia, I believe it's like 50% at least of the population is under 15. You know, some numbers like this. And we, you know, sometimes we have a lot of these protests, and we have sometimes instability, which you know, seemingly seems like ethnic kind of strife, right? But I think it all boils down to economic opportunities. Who gets economic opportunities? Who doesn't? And when young people don't have opportunities, I think like when they're hopeless, they're more like they're going to be discontent, and you'll have instability, political instability, right? And I think artificial intelligence is, a lot of people are investing into it. It's starting to touch every single sector of society, from healthcare to agriculture to all sorts of other things. And it's the next wave of technology, right? So I think that just by creating companies and other opportunities and research that employ artificial intelligence, we can create opportunities for young people.
If we can get African entrepreneurs funded and off the ground and deploying tools, because they know the problems. People are very entrepreneurial. They know the problems, and they just need to have the support, and they need to not, they just need local support.
Well, they talk about leapfrogging. They talk about the fact that data ecosystems are growing up around in different parts of Africa. I think using AI, machine learning methods to extract value, economic value from those data sources, that's going to be huge. I think the financial inclusion work, driving financial inclusion through advanced intelligence will be a huge boon for the entire continent. Health systems will probably improve if we have better diagnostic abilities driven by artificial intelligence. I think those two logistical systems also might improve. There's a lot of stuff we can do with machine learning if we are properly motivated and properly funded to do it right.
It's the most important disruption currently happening, AI, and it's a great opportunity for Africa if we rise up and collaborate to seize it.
Of course, one is the banking industry. Already the coming of blockchain, bitcoins, cryptocurrencies, the banks are already getting shaken. So, of course, as the number of people begin to appreciate these technologies and begin to adopt these technologies, I think there will be a lot of change in the way that these guys are providing their services, and of course it will have a greater economic value, because most people now spend. You find that the banks deduct money which people never planned for. From the account, so you find that you've got your money at the bank, and then suddenly there's this money that's being deducted by the bank. So with the coming of these technologies, there'll be no third parties involved. So subsequently, I think in terms of people's money just getting deducted without no proper cause, I think that will be something of the past. I'm a boring person.
I have very few teeth.
I grew up in Tatooine, the sand planet of Star Wars, so a lot of people don't believe it exists, but it does. It's the last city before the Sahara.
Okay, my fun fact is maybe that I sometimes read more fashion blogs than I do research papers.
I once fell off a boat in the middle of the Pacific, or was it the Atlantic, doing a handstand. Yeah, I think that's as fun as it gets. There's more details there, but we'll leave it aside.
I am really random, and I think this answer is part of that. I'm very relaxed, and I sometimes do things that maybe I ought to not do them, but I don't always feel bad about it. I believe you should just be yourself in all spaces. All spaces, work, life, everything.
I would say like I am an excessive dancer. I really love dancing, so just you'll find me more or less dancing in almost every night.
I love dancing. I still do a lot of, you know, dancing, but specifically like New York style salsa. That's New York style mambo, right? And so back in the day, I was addicted. Like I would dance all the time. So I would dance until the point that, you know, my feet had like blisters, but I did not want to stop dancing. No. What I did was I would wrap each toe with band-aids. I wrapped each toe with band-aids to get rid of the blisters, and I would still dance until I just could not move anymore, and then I would stop. So that's it.